You can stand now.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back online, and we had a temporary glitch in technology, but we are back, thank God. Are there any other questions on the presentation to ask of group three, please, for the other students? I know there was a spirited discussion on schizophrenia, which is a very interesting topic. But are there any other questions to ask of group three? Are there any if there are no questions, then we will have to go, then we will continue now with the lecture. I'm trying to see if I can get in a case for practice. We really have a shortened time. But we do the best we can. What I wanted to bring to discuss this evening is to touch on the neurocognitive disorders and personality disorders. The neurocognitive and the personality disorders. That's one of the other categories of mental disturbances. Now, before I go into that, let me just kind of underscore about the DSM and its makeup. Now, the DSM, as you know, now takes a dimensional slash categorical approach. Is someone trying to come in, Mr. Nyame?
So it's Michelle, but she's going in the wrong place. So I'm directing her.
Okay, all right, good. All right, so let's continue. So as I said, it takes a very dimensional approach. Dimensional means that there are facets to abnormality. That is culture, environment, family, personality, and actually the person's coping styles and cultural context. So basically, what I did not say in the discussion of the DSM-5 is that the DSM-5 has what is known as elements of a diagnosis, or constitutes elements of a diagnosis. And this is that it's specific diagnostic criteria and descriptors of each disorder are key in the DSM-5. It outlines the diagnostic criteria in which you are going to make inferences from mental phenomena and to make that comparison to determine if this is actually the diagnosis. So there are So the diagnostic criteria also has what is known as diagnostic features. Diagnostic features. That is, in the DSM, it's going to look at, as I talked about, comorbidity. That there are some disorders that are common or commonly associated with some categories of disorders. For example, people talk about schizophrenia. I remember in the presentation, and they talked about substance abuse. Schizophrenia and substance abuse are linked, because in more ways than one, this person.
Okay, close friends.
In more ways than one, the person who has schizophrenia will necessarily abuse substances. So. But then what's also important is that there are also differential diagnoses, and it's important when you are making informed diagnosis, there has to be differential. In other words, you're looking at a set of symptoms and you are making the comparison, a standard criteria against a certain set of symptoms, and you're making, you are determining what else is it, what are these symptoms, what do they represent. Remember, I said before in the past that not all symptoms within that category are the same. People do not manifest symptoms similarly. So most persons are heterotypic. They have different symptoms. And so you have to be very mindful about how, when you're diagnosing, what are you going to be looking for in the symptoms? Do they all, are they all similar, or they are they dissimilar? But another key thing I wanted to underscore is the matter of subtypes. Now in this video, I mean, sorry, in this presentation, there are several subtypes. One talk about the disorganized type, and people can bear me up if Ms. Thompson and others who did the presentation, could you bear me up? Unmute your mics, Ms. Thompson, group three. The subtypes of schizophrenia?
Yes, Dr. Mack, they're disorganized.
Go ahead and tell them, please.
Disorganized, catatonic.
That's correct.
There's
catatonic, and undifferentiated type,
Yes, so, I'm mixing up the word, yes. And they're listed in the DSM-4, not the 5.
Yes, but even though you still need to make a differentiation even in 5. Because when you're treating schizophrenia, if you're depending on the type it is. So the DSM-5 does still have subtypes. So now the difference with that, now subtypes are like, for example, they are mutually exclusive. And they are based upon phenomenological symptoms in a particular subgroup. So each disorder has a certain amount of symptoms that are prevalent in each person. So most persons who will be depressed, one of the key things of a depression, for example, is depressed mood or low energy or suicidal ideations. That's when you know that somebody is seriously ill. So therefore, a subtype then is mutually exclusive and looks at phenomenological symptoms and groupings. So specifiers then give an opportunity to them to make a more narrow defined specification of what type of disorder this is. For example, in major depression, is it recurrent? Is it single episode? So single or recurrent suggests that you have had more than one episode. So it's more narrowing. Major depression is more general, and you're moving to the specific in terms of the specified. You're saying this is the type of depression it is. It's called single episode. This person has had a first episode of depression, or they have had a series of depression over the time. On mutual max, is that clear, please?
Yes, Dr.
Mutual max, is that very clear?
Yes, Dr. Mack.
I just want to make certain that when you're coding, you need to do the specifier and the subtype. So for example, schizophrenia, 2.95.30 schizophrenia, paranoid type, subtype, acute onset, specify. Is that clear?
Yes, Dr. Mack.
Good.
Yes, Dr. Ma.
And so you have in the you have your principal diagnosis, and continuing, you are going to have your you are going to have your principal diagnosis, which is the main disorder. Now I need to briefly go through the ICD-10, and then you're going to have a provincial diagnosis. Provincial diagnosis is when you don't have sufficient information to make a full-fledged diagnosis. You use provisionally. It means then that once you have additional information, you can say yes. So provisional means that you are thinking about other symptoms, but you don't have information at the time of the interview. Is that clear? Is that clear?
Yes, Dr. Mann.
I'm not certain if it's, am I boring you? It's the last night, but.
Yes, Dr. Mack, it's clear.
It's Dr. Mack.
I need to get a bottle of wine here, see? Nice.
Maybe open we're tired, Dr. Mack.
I think we're all tired.
Maybe but tiredness.
Yeah, that, let me just quickly, if you can, are you able to do the case then? Are you able to do the case?
If we're able to do the case, Dr. Mack?
Yes.
You're talking? It would be good for us to go through it because you said it would be good for us to go through it because you were saying
so. I think so. But let me just briefly. I don't know. We have a lot. We can't cover everything. But I wanted to go through the ICD. Now the ICD, known as ICD-10. I sent Mr. Nyame. Could you put it up? I sent it to you. If you need, want me to, I'll send it to you by email because it's up on the platform. I just sent it to him for him to put up there. But the ICD-10 is also a diagnostic tool that deals primarily medical and health management. The ICD-10, I think I'll talk about this briefly, that the ICD-10 is used to monitor the incidence and prevalences of medical diseases. It's used by most of the countries in the world. Only North America uses the DSM-5. But now people, because people have been having trouble with the DSM-5, they're going to the ICD-10 classifications. So I'm just going to say, I'll send this to you that you can read it for yourselves. But just to say that it's really now used and it's now twinned with the DSM-5 when you're coding. So as I said before, it has been 100 people use it, 100 countries rather use it, and it has been translated into 43 languages. So it also defines diseases, disorders, injuries, and other related health conditions. So it's primarily for health reasons. And just to let you know that the DSM-11 is on the way. It's going to come out in 2017.
Dr. Mack, just one clarification. You said 100 countries use it?
Yes.
Okay.
Most of the countries in the world use it.
Okay, yes. And you mean the ICD-11? Not the
DSM-10. The ICD-11
has
come out. Yeah. Okay. The ICD-11 is to come out. It's been worked on. Like the DSM-5, it's been worked on. So in 2017, it's going to be coming out. So I will send this to you as soon as the class is convened. I'll send this to you that you can be familiar with it. Now, do you have a problem? Yes, Mr. Name.
You may have to send me back because I'm not sure what it is called.
I sent you a recent email just about an hour ago.
Okay, let me check that.
That has all of that there, so they can get it because we don't really have the time. Time is of the essence. Now, it's a toss-up, students. Do you want me to go through the case or you want me to continue with the classifications?
Dr. Mack, just to clarify, is this the case you said would help us with the take-home test?
Yes. I'll send you a sample of it to give you what I'm expecting for you to do.
Oh, well, great. Then I would like to go through it then.
Okay, Dr. Mack.
All right, let's go to the case. All right, so then we'll convene the classifications. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have any questions, feel free to email and I'll be happy to spend some time outside the classroom to explain, but we are out of time. This is a very, very broad course, and it's So what I'll do, Mr. Naomi, I did send it. I sent you a child case in that email. Could you put it up, please?
Child case study too. I'll put
That's
it up.
That's correct. Could you put it up, please? Ladies and gentlemen, okay. So what we could do for speed of, and we can read it, and rather than people reading together, I just read and talk and go through the case quickly.
Okay.
Also, I think it's probably a good idea to go through that exam for you to, for me to be clear as to what I need from you. Is that, do you want me to do that?
That would be extremely helpful, Dr. Mark.
Okay.
So we know whether we have to write 30 pages or 100 pages.
Is there anybody else who doesn't agree? Are people in agreement that they don't agree? Sorry?
For that, Dr. Mark.
The scripture?
I'm asking a question as it relates to the movie, a section in the movie assignment.
What about Miss Osborne?
Where it's saying presenting complaint.
Yes.
I am not sure what I am to do here as it relates to what the person said when she went to the psychologist.
What are you talking about? I'm confused.
No, oh, sorry. Okay, I'm talking about the movie.
Okay.
Assignment.
Yes.
But when it asks for presenting a complaint,
mm-hmm.
If the person went and said they did not have a problem, that's what I should write as their presenting complaint, or I should.
No. There has to be presenting complaints in that video, because you're doing a case study, and a case study would have had some form of problems the character in the movie is having. I would hate to think that they're not having that problem.
No, man, I know that they do have a problem. The person did have a problem, but as it relates to what they present to the psychologist. So,
what psychologist are you talking about? Are you talking about a particular movie?
Yes.
Okay, no, I don't know what movie you're referring to, so I can't really answer in the affirmative. I don't know what movie that is.
Okay, I'm doing The Best Little Girl in the World.
Okay, I have not seen that movie. But
she did not have any problem.
Well, she probably is in denial. If she's, but you, that's where you need to use your thinking skills to have to be critical. If you see problems and she said that there is, then she's in denial. She lacks insight.
Okay.
Any other questions while we are waiting for that case to be on to be presented? Mr. Nyama, when we put the case up, would it be recorded that people can see it after the when you're going back to the?
Yes, I'll put it on Moodle as well.
Okay, great. Now what I'm saying, can they see it when they after this is recorded? Can they see it when they're watching, going back to the lecture?
No, they won't.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to put it in the chat area.
Okay, so we'll click on it and bring it up.
Yeah.
Kojo.
Hello?
I'm not sure how to do it on the iPad, so is there any way that it could compromise? No, I can't. Here's the other question I'm going to ask. Is it on the Moodle platform?
I'm going to be putting it up there now.
Okay, because if you put it there, I could probably access it from there and just use look at both places at the same time.
Okay. I could just forward the email to you.
Okay, fine, no problem.
Yeah. All right, this, you know, I can click on it now.
Okay, I'm having a good one. Dr. Ma.
We're ready. Okay, this is a case of a short case that was really part of a comprehensive exam a couple years ago, two years ago.
Dr. Mark, yeah. one minute, please. Can you just give me a minute?
Sure. I'll take a glass of wine while I wait.
Thank you very much. Of course, are you
email? I send it on email.
Okay, all right. I'm looking.
Are we ready now?
I see the classifications is what it is, Kojo?
No, it's a case.
Yes. Child case study one. Case study two.
Oh, okay. Okay, Dr. Mac, thank you very much.
All right, okay, let's, do we all have the case on, do we all have the case?
Yes, Dr. Mac.
Okay.
Yes, Dr. Mac.
I'm going to be reading, it's a very short one, a clip, that's why, and we'll go through each paragraph, analyze it step by step, what I'm expecting you, how to expect you to answer the questions. At the time of the assessment, the patient, John, was a 3.5-year-old boy, the only child of an upper middle class family. So in a case like this, you are going to note age of onset for the child. He was referred by his father, who reported that months prior to the assessment, the boy had been bitten on the neck by a leopard. Determine whether or not months is in the same age 3 or is it earlier. Since the time of the attack, the time of onset, he had experienced numerous problems. He would wake 2 to 4 times each night and would have frequent nightmares involving monster animals and monsters. John exhibited a reluctance to be apart from his mother. The onset of these symptoms began with the bite of a leopard and present a marked change from his behavior prior to the event. In addition, over the past 5 months that had elapsed from the time of the attack of the assessment, there was little amelioration of the symptoms that occurred. Now, very important first paragraph, because it's giving you all in one date of onset. What's the date of onset, ladies and gentlemen? Age of onset, rather.
Three
and a half years. So when we are going to time of onset, we are looking then for when the incident of the problem started. In this case, the problem lasted for the duration of onset, or the duration that it was three for several months, correct?
So there's a difference between time of onset, Dr. Mark, age of onset, and duration of.
But I've been singing that song for quite a long time, Miss is this Miss Johnson?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
I've been singing that song for quite a long time. Yes, what do you understand by age of onset and time of onset? Tell me. What is your confusion? Let me help you out of your obfuscation. By giving you a glass of proverbial wine to stimulate the cerebral cortex. What's your confusion?
I guess for the last two lectures, the challenge that I'm having with age and time of onset is it that age is referring to a particular year old, so the person is 20 years old when the disorder developed.
Okay, all right. I tell you what, this is what I want to do, because I think I suspect people are confused or near in the state of oblivious confusion. I said age of onset. Always use to determine when it's used primarily to determine giving you an indication of the category of disorders that they are. So in terms of it's probably linked to course of the disorder. Let me repeat. Age of, you need to take this down. It's being recorded, thank God. Age of onset is linked to course of the disorder because age chronologically gives us an idea of the child's age when the disorder normally occurs. For example, in schizophrenia, it will occur from teens to 20 years, in the 20s or 30s. On mutual mics, is that clear? Hello?
Yes, Dr. Ma.
Yes, Dr.
Ms. Spencer, yes, I've not heard your chorus. Do you understand?
So Dr. Mac, just perhaps, for clarification. Oh, go ahead, Marshall. Go ahead.
Nothing, perhaps when I hear the definition for time of onset.
Okay, okay. But I want to underscore that people understand about about age first.
So Dr. Mac, are you saying then that the diagnostic criteria is normally mentioned, say for antisocial?
There is a range of ages that the onset of a disorder occurs. In other words, you would have child with this. In other words, let's say, for example, separation anxiety. You would not have separation anxiety in a teenager. It has to occur in a young child before age 5.
Right, but Dr. Mac,
that's why it's age of onset.
I'm asking you this question to understand. I'm just asking this question to understand it in my head. Based on the definition that you give as it relates to the course of the disorder, and the idea of the child and when it would normally occur. Here's my question. Say, for instance, the antisocial.
I think you're breaking. There's a vibration. I don't know if people are not, if people have their mics on it. So I'm not hearing you very clearly. I'm sorry.
Okay. All right, Dr. Mac, it's okay.
No. We need to answer the question. I don't want you to go away in what I call pools of confusion. we have to use the proverbial Chateau, Cabernet, Sauvignon. It's on my table.
Okay, Dr. Mac. Are you hearing better?
Yes, I'm hearing you now.
Okay, thank you. Right. What I'm saying is that based on the definition that you just gave, I just want to use something to see if that is what you're saying. So,
yes.
For instance, as
yes. You're still fading out. I'm not hearing you, Fergie. I don't know what's happening.
What is happening, Dr. Mac, is that I
much better. Go ahead now.
I have to bend down onto the iPad. All right. What I'm saying.
I'm so sorry about that.
That's okay. What I'm saying is that just to clarify your definition that you just gave a while ago.
Yes.
That it's a course. So I'm just wanting to use an example to see if that is what you're saying. So say, for instance, in the case of a person who has an antisocial personality disorder and the diagnostic criteria speaks to age, starting at age 14 or age 18 and that type of a thing.
Mm-hmm.
Is it that we would look at those age ranges as it relates to a disorder to determine the age of onset?
Well, yes, but there are some disorders, though. Some disorders, in other words, the age of onset deals with ranges of disorders.
Okay.
So, for example, the personality disorders must occur after age 18. May I repeat myself? The personality disorders is an adult disorder.
Okay.
You don't diagnose children with personality disorders. Anybody who tells you that they're lying and they're not telling the truth. Personality disorders are considered adult disorders. Children do not have the capacity to manifest. Now, let me say this: there is a precursor for a child in manifestation, like conduct disorder, is a precursor for antisocial, but you cannot diagnose a child before age 18 with an antisocial personality.
But Dr. Mack, it wasn't the diagnosis I was trying to get at, you know. It was the understanding of the age of onset that I was trying to get at.
Yes, but it's the same point that age of onset is linked to the diagnosis itself. There are some disorders that are specifically childhood disorders.
Okay.
Of course, with the DSM-5, some disorders in childhood have been put into other disorders. For example, like the feeding disorders are put into the eating, into that category of eating disorders in adult disorders. But generally speaking, things like separation anxiety that become between age five are considered primarily childhood disorders.
All right, let me use a childhood disorder then. So to use that particular example, because I'm not so often with childhood disorders. So yes. To use that particular example where the anxiety would come to the fore the age 5.
I'm sorry, I missed that. It was blurry. I didn't hear you.
The separation anxiety disorder, that would be around age 5, you said?
Yes.
All right. So, say for instance, a case, and it had a disorder here, and the child was a...
I'm still miss... Oh, dear. I cannot hear.
It's okay, Dr. Mack.
No. We'll try to help you. I'm just saying if you can make it to the point where I can hear very clearly.
Okay. I'm trying to make the
point. You're garbled.
I'm just trying to make the point to see if, because if I understand your definition, I'm just trying to use the criteria in the DSM to see if that would kind of make the age of onset a little clearer. So to use a childhood disorder that you just mentioned,
mm-hmm.
where age 5 would be the point of onset then, as it were. If you gave us a case, are you hearing me now, Dr. Mack?
Yes, I'm very clear enough.
So if you gave us a case and separation anxiety disorder would be the issue.
Yes.
And the child is, say, 6 years old or 5, would the age of onset then in that particular case be 5?
Not necessarily. No, there is a certain age range. So separation anxiety. So, look at it. Age of onset is really developmentally driven. That's why there's a course. That's why I talked about developmental disorders. How does this disorder progress? So it doesn't necessarily mean that the 5. That's when the child starts having separation anxiety. It can be because. Children in a separation, it can be due also to stressors, but in terms of the outcome of when it starts, it's usually at age 5.
Okay, Dr. Mack.
So that's why you have to pay attention to the age of onset, because it will lead you to determine, okay, which disorders in the DSM would, like in the 20s. So, for example, borderline personality disorders also starts in the 20s, but it remits in age 40. After a certain period, it goes away.
Okay, Mac. Understood.
So let me continue. Yes, I'm sorry, I missed it. Does it then mean that the age of onset determines the course and category of a specific disorder between child... Yes, Mr. Chiana. Yes, very good phrasing. Yes, it does. Just remember that age of one is the course.
What did he say, Dr. Mack? Can you just read it out? I'm not able
Does it then mean that the age of onset determine the course and category of a specific disorder between child and adult disorder?
Okay.
Yes. Any questions to unmute your mics, please, with the age of onset? I'm sorry that this late stage we haven't been able to differentiate and people are still having challenges. Is it clear? If you can unmute your mics for questions, please. feel free. If you're still not understanding, I'll be happy to help you, but feel free. Age of onset. Ms. Spencer.
Yes, Dr. Matt. I think I understand, Dr. Matt. I'm not sure, but...
Tell me what you understand.
Well, you're saying age of onset it relates to a particular age range. So each disorder...
Yes, according to the DSM, that is the range, that is the time when it should start. It normally starts.
So
age is linked to time, because with the age, it depends on how long the person has it. So it may mean a period of time that this disorder is manifesting itself. But it starts. But in other words, this is where it starts, and this is a standard for it to start. So 5, 18, or 20. So conduct disorder starts before what? Before 12. Opposition disorder starts before 10. Between 10 and 12, young children have that kind of problem. People with conduct disorders will more likely start early, but you cannot say they have a personal disorders until they reach 18. So even though they may have conduct disorders between, say, it starts between, say, 12 and up to 15, 16. Once they reach 18, it no longer is a child with disorder, it's not an adult personality disorder. Is it clear?
Yes.
Is it clear? Yes, 18 is the standard for personality disorders, especially antisocial.
No, and Dr. Mack, I was very clear about that. You know, I was just using it as an example to see if I could understand.
Well, I understand. I just want to make sure people understand. But so let's go to the time of onset.
What is the difference between the age of onset and the date? For example, I see
the
here
date
on
the of onset.
I see on the individual paper where it is asking for the date of each symptom.
The date of each symptom?
Observe.
You certain about that?
I'm reading it.
Maybe I had what I call a lapse of
It's a date of onset of each symptom.
Let me see something here, because I don't recall.
Which is that, Eileen?
It is.
Okay, are you going to the exam? Because I'm trying to get to the case. So let me do that separately. We're going to confuse the issue. Let's get to this, finish up this course. I mean, this case, please. Okay, so let's continue. So I was saying let me get back.
Time of onset,
doctor. Is related to time of onset is related to the development of symptoms. It's related to the development of symptoms between a certain period. The symptoms can be a few days, a day, as in a brief psychotic disorder, 6 months or less, as in schizophrenia, post-traumatic stress disorder, a month, as in a major depressive. That's when the symptoms will stay there. It's linked. Time is linked to age. So at this age, this is what happened. Within this age range, these are the set of symptoms that started to happen. So it's
Dr.
linked.
Ma.
Yes.
Sorry. No, I was going to ask, so in the diagnostic criteria where it say the symptoms are present for 6 months,
that's time of onset? That's correct.
Okay, thank you. Thank
it's linked
you.
To diagnostic criteria. Very good, yes. Linked to the diagnostic criteria. When it says 6 months, that's time. That is when it has to, in other words, that's when it must happen. Now, duration is how long the period is. So, duration is separate from the time of onset. So, you can have the symptoms developing at age 3. For 2 months, but then it got worse at 7 months. That's duration, sir. So 2 from 7 is 5. So for 5 months, this person has this problem. That's called duration, because duration of onset is linked to severity of symptoms. Is it getting worse or is it getting bad? In most cases, duration means that the symptoms are so bad that the person starts to impact people start getting disabled and dysfunctional, and it's starting to affect people's functioning.
But can you have a 20 year duration, Dr. Ma?
No, you cannot. If you have a 20 year duration, just to use it, I don't know of it. I know of major depressive disorder recurrent, that where you have, it's not necessarily 20 years, it's more episodic, where you have several periods within that 20 year span. You may have 5, or you may have someone with bipolar illness who may have several episodes of mania or depression combined. But most duration in the DSM is 6 months or less, a month, 2 weeks, or a day. Is it clear? Let me go back. 1 year in a depressive disorder in children, called unspecified consent disorder. 2 years in adults, up to 2 years. 6 months or less in terms of certain categories of disorders. 2 weeks in terms of the duration of onset in depression. 1 day or and less than a month in a brief psychotic disorders. But those are the range of durations. Those are the those are the numerical values for duration of symptoms. Not 20 years, no. So the DSM will give you a guide in terms of that. Guiding.
Dr. Ma?
Yes.
I am not clear on between time and duration of onset. Because what you've just explained sounds to me in terms of
my battery's going to go. So
it sounds very similar to time of onset.
Hold on, just a moment. Let me plug my battery in if I won't have a problem. So I have to plug it into the socket because it's saying running very low, 10%. Just a moment. I will disappear for a little bit and plug it and come back. Okay, yes, ask your question now, please. I'm back.
Yes, Dr. Mark. I was saying I'm not very clear on the difference between time of onset and duration of onset. You explained that duration is linked to severity of symptoms, but based on the explanation you just gave...
Emerging of the symptoms. Time of onset.
Right.
The emerging of the symptoms. When they
started,
that's it. That's all it is.
But based on the explanation you just gave, for duration of onset of 6 months and a year, I'm not sure what is the difference.
Time is when it started. And so if it started
6 months ago?
No. Time, just look at it. You're looking at it concretely. Time is when the symptoms started to emerge. It's an emerging symptom. So its symptoms are acute. So in this case with Johnny, let me go and plug it in. So he was bitten on the neck by a leopard. So since the time of the attack, he had experienced numerous problems. That's time of onset. So since he was bitten by that, he was numb. So his time of onset means that the symptoms have emerged, a change of psychological function of the person. So time of onset in comparison to pre-morbid function before the person was stable was that something happened. It normally is when a stressor occurs and the person starts to develop these symptoms. So in case of little Johnny, he developed problems. So this is just explaining the symptoms, so the onset of the symptoms begin with the bite of a leopard. And in other words, it started for him. It doesn't give the specificity of the time, but what it is saying is that since the incident, he started to have these problems. So when you're thinking of time of onset, you are more thinking of process and chronology. In other words,
Does that mean that time of onset does not necessarily have to be reflected in days or months? As in the example you used, from the time he was bitten?
No. It time of onset means that it can be reflected because it can tell you when the symptoms emerge and how long those symptoms have been occurring.
But using the case study, it was from when he was bitten. No. It doesn't give a specific time.
Yes, but there's no evidence here. But I'm explaining what it is. So don't get confused by this. What you need to pay attention to is the duration of symptoms in this case. There is a time of onset, but there's no specific time when it started. It says months prior to the assessment.
If we're given a case like that, mm-hmm. For time of onset, we would say not stated?
Could be, but then you're expected to determine what are the symptoms.
Duration
of the time of onset. No, forget about duration. For time of onset, it says months prior to the assessment, the boy had been bitten. So before the child came to you, he had been bitten by a leopard on his neck. That's time of onset. The symptoms started when he was bitten months. So in other words, it's implied that it occurred for months. The symptoms occurred months before he came to you for an assessment.
So that would work, just months. We don't have to put a value to the months.
No, it just says months.
Okay.
But listen carefully here. So during that months, this is what is occurring. The symptoms, duration of symptoms, he would wake 2 to 4 times each night and have frequent nightmares. So after being bitten by the leopard, months after with the assessment, he started to have these symptoms. So what is the duration? In other words, duration means that the symptoms have begun to get take on a certain severity of symptoms. For example, 2 to 3, 4 times a night, you would wake up having nightmares involving animals and monsters. Then he would start developing anxiety. So those are symptoms within the duration that says to you that this situation is acute, is beginning. So it says again, the onset of these symptoms began with the bite of the leopard. So in addition, over the 5 months that had elapsed, so obviously it took 5 months of the same problems for him to now get an assessment. So at the time of the of the disturbance, months before, we don't have a definitive numerical value, but we do know that once he was bitten, months before the assessment, he had this problem. And it is saying then that 5 months after the, on top of those months, so in other words, it probably was, could be 10, 12 months afterwards. If you add 5 and the other months together, that gives you the duration of onset. Is it clear? Uh-uh. Is it clear?
Okay. Dr. Max, so if you add the 5 and which other?
No, no, no. I'm saying to you that people will not come to you when symptoms are beginning. So, for example, somebody who has had depression, mm-hmm. and this depression started 2 years ago.
Okay.
They may not come, but then 5 months later, after 2 years, or within 5 months, within that 2 year span, in other words, it started to get worse. So more than likely, let me say this, that time of onset and duration of onset are linked. Time is when the symptoms started, and it will lead now to how long the person waited before they come for help. Is it clearer?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Let me repeat.
Yes, Dr. Mark.
They will wait until they come for it. When it is the duration, it's when it's so bad they can't stand it anymore. That is what the duration of onset is. Wait too long. 6 years.
So 5 months in this case.
So 5 months they wait for the problem, the same thing happening. For example, nightmares, waking up. It took 5 months for them to come to get that duration of symptoms.
Okay.
Very simple. Okay. Very, very simple. I think I'll need a glass of wine, ladies and gentlemen.
Victor, I've had something in the chat here.
Okay, let me see that. I didn't have... Where's? Let me bring it up, because I have not seen that. Hold on, please. What is he saying?
Time of answer.
Okay, very good. He says, and he's the time of onset in this case study, can it be said that he was 3 years, 5? No, can't be. Why not? Can't be. Why would that be 3 years and 5 months, ladies and gentlemen?
Why would that come up?
Why would it not be? He's asking the question. Onset in this case study, can it be said that he was 3 years and 5 months when the incident occurred?
I think that's the client's age, Dr. Ma.
No, he said 3 years, 5 months.
No.
It's impossible.
No, sorry. The client is 3.5 years old.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
So it's 1 month less than the client's age.
Yes, but not only that. It's we have to learn to differentiate between numbers. In a case, we have to learn to solve the problems. So 3.5 age, that is when he was bitten. Let me put it another way, very clearly and concretely. At 3.5, the child was bitten by a leopard in his neck. So months, it happened months after. So months after the incident, he allowed this problem to continue without going anywhere and getting any help. But then 5 months later, in addition to those months that those symptoms developed, it started to get real bad, and they said, no, we have to go get help. Because he started to get very anxious, and he couldn't, and so he was developing a lot of anxiety. So in the duration of symptoms, it is assumed that the symptoms are now acute and severe for them to get help. Whenever duration of symptoms mean that the person is coming to you when they can't stand it anymore, they need they have to get help. It's getting bad. That's what it means. They keep it too long. Is it clear?
Yes, Dr. Ma.
Is it clear, Mr. Victor? Is it clear? Clear as water or red as wine?
Crystal, Dr. Mac, crystal, that's the word you use.
Well, the wine is looking at me to have a drink. But not tonight, it's too late for that. I don't drink anyway. But do you understand what I'm trying to say to you?
Yes.
Okay, let's continue because we time is going, please. Where's the case? All right, so let's look at it. So therefore, basically, what are you noticing about this, the first paragraph, ladies and gentlemen? This is where now you start to look at symptoms. Emerging symptoms. I said to you before that there are two types of symptomatology. One that's emerging, when it's more acute, and one that is chronic, when it's getting worse. In this case, is it worse or is it acute that he needs help? What scenarios you look at the mental phenomena? In this case, he was what? He had sleep disturbances, correct? He did not sleep disturbances where he's waking up, he's having nightmares, and then he started to have some separation issues from his mother. Do you see that?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Do you see that?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
And so the onset of his symptoms suggests that he has some marked behavioral change. Do you see that? In other words, not sleeping at night, dreaming about monsters, and can't separate from his mother. Those are signs or symptoms, ladies and gentlemen. Are they signs or symptoms?
Oh, it's a question.
Oh dear. I think you've fallen asleep.
It never sounded like a question, Dr. Max. So you're asking if the behavior, if these are signs.
Are they, yes, or symptoms. Mm-hmm.
They're symptoms.
Or tell me if there's, what is a sign to you and what are symptoms? What is symptoms? What are the child? What is a child manifesting?
Anxiety.
Yeah.
It's a level of anxiety being displayed.
Okay, so there's an anxiety. Anybody else? In other words, begin to think about categories of disorders in children, especially in the neurodevelopmental disorders. Can't go to adults because it's not an adult, this is a child. So you have to start thinking about, is it a child with disorder? He's not sleeping very well. He's having nightmares. Which set of disorders would do this to a child? He's not separating from his mother, so in other words, he's having issues, he's regressing. So, let's continue. So let's look then at what are the symptoms and signs, by the way? What are the symptoms? Anxiety is one. Anything else? Child is having nightmares. Isn't that a symptom? Hello?
Nightmares. That's a symptom, Dr. Mark.
Sorry?
Well, symptoms would refer to anxiety, fear, that mm-hmm. sort of thing. but I didn't think.
No, but is what are the symptoms in the vine in paragraph one? Not able to sleep is a symptom.
Right.
It's sleep disturbance. Yes. Nightmares is another symptom. And anxiety is another symptom.
Right, separation anxiety.
Okay, we don't know that yet. He was able to separate from his mother. That's anxiety. We don't know yet. Let's not jump the gun. Let's go to paragraph two for us to build on case conceptualization. So we have the presenting problem. We have some presenting problem. We are going through case formulae. We are building hypotheses as we talked about yesterday. We are building hypotheses. Those are what we think may be happening. Let's continue. On review of the history, it was revealed that a week following the boy's discharge from the hospital. So, obviously, the 5 months duration of symptoms when he had to come in for an assessment. A week after that he was discharged from hospital. Can you mute your mic, please? Okay. Week after he was discharged from hospital. He went to a pet store. And the store kept a leopard on display enclosed in a particular cage that was made up of bars and a protective glass shield with a gap between the top of the cage and the glass ceiling of the display room. While the boy was watching, the leopard leaped up, managed to get through the gap and bit the boy on their necks and head. Bleeding and finding no help available, the father managed to keep the leopard away to permit the retreat out of the store. They were taken to the local hospital where the lacerations were repaired. Now, on Mutual Max, tell me if this is part of the history or continuation of the boy's symptoms. Unmute your mics. Tell me what are you picking up from this second paragraph?
It would appear as if this is somewhat of a causation.
In other words, it is explaining what actually happened, why this child has his symptoms.
Right.
In other words, initially he went into hospital to remove his tonsils, and having gone to a pet store, he got bitten by a lion. By a leopard. So it's explaining. In other words, you're getting collateral history from the parent to explain this behavior. The child can't tell you, the parent has to tell you. So this is more history gathering of find out what happened. What happened? How, what, and when, you remember? This is asking about what happened. Why did these symptoms occur? Let's continue. The attack by the leopard marked the onset of symptoms. That is when the problem starts. The minute he was bitten by the leopard, the problems emerged, started. Immediately after the attack, the child acted terrified. He cried and screamed. Why did the leopard bite? He bit Daddy. Daddy has blood all over him. On his return home from the hospital emergency department, he began to experience problems with sleeping. So all this is talking about history and explaining how the child developed the symptoms. So this is a pre-event explaining, giving you a previous history of what happened, and then it begin to show you after this incident, then the child started to develop these unusual symptoms after this incident happened. So unmute your mic, is it clear?
Dr. Ma. Yes, ma.
Is it very clear? All this two-part history, explaining the symptoms, emerging symptoms, explaining how the symptoms come about, explaining how the child got bitten. Nothing to do with symptoms, just telling you what it is. So when you're doing your history, you're going to get this information to understand. Let's go to the third.
Fourth.
Beg your pardon. Sorry. So it's now telling you post-event. It is now saying duration of symptoms. Prior to meeting with the leper, the boy had been content to play outside by himself, and he was always happy to see the... Look at it. It is showing about pre-morbid function. Prior to that, if you go in the first paragraph, it says he was afraid to part from his mother, correct? In this instance, he was happy to part from her. You notice that? Do you notice that?
Yes, Dr. Man.
However, with the incident, he began to show a reluctance and a concern about being separated from his mother. When somebody go into and begin to now formulate into your thoughts, what is this saying to you? What are you thinking? Which disorder will bring this kind of behavior? Think about it. And if you have a DSM-5, open it and let us look. And let us look at the horse buggy paradigm and let us make a comparison. What are you thinking? What are your hypotheses? It's not fact. We don't have a diagnosis. We don't know yet. What are your thoughts? What do you think is wrong with this child? Unmute your mics, please. What is wrong with this child? Hello? Hello?
Yes, Dr. Mark. Sounds like there's some level of anxiety, but I'm not sure.
Okay, tell us your evidence. Show us where you got that from.
Well, him not sleeping, not wanting to be apart from his mom, his response after himself and his father were bitten.
Okay, but ask us the question, what type of anxiety, if you're correct?
Yeah, well, that is, I need to go into the DSM for, I'm not,
no,
it's
no, no.
Definitely not, can, it's not separation anxiety.
You can infer from the beginning.
Why wouldn't it be separated?
I'm not very familiar with all of the childhood and the childhood disorders.
Miss, at this, you need to start getting familiar with the childhood disorders. Because you will not always have it with you in a patient.
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Okay, Miss Hall, you were saying something. You were saying you're on the verge of perpetual brilliance. And happy anniversary to you, Christmas to you with a bottle of wine.
Okay. With the separation anxiety, Dr. Mark.
Yes. Go ahead.
She's saying it's not separation, but for me so far, maybe it's too early to determine whether it is, but separation has to do with a clinginess and fearfulness.
I think I'm going to fall off my chair with your brilliance. And tell us why.
This is not the child's usual behavior and being clingy to his parents. It's okay, after the occasion.
So we are looking at pre-morbid function then. We are making a comparison between what the child was before the accident and the child now. Right?
Right. Yes,
so
ma'am.
Would you agree with me, ladies and gentlemen, that there is a marked deterioration in social and behavioral function in this child?
Yes,
is there disability? Is there disability? Is there dysfunction in this child?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Okay, so if there's this function, our hypotheses have been widened. Let's continue. Do we have the DSM-5 open, please? So we know we have symptoms of separation, we have anxiety, we have nightmares.
Right.
Anything else? Anything else?
We're still on the second paragraph.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? Continue.
Oh, me?
No, well, let me continue because he was a peeling child that was quite talkative.
Right.
Warm and interested. In the initial meeting, he loudly announced that he had been bitten by a mosquito on the way to the assessment. However, this was not too bad because mosquitoes could never eat you up, and because mommy could help. Members of a toy family then begin to get hurt. They would fall and hurt their legs. Members of the family could not get help or they would hurt too. Doctors were called, but they got hurt, and no one would help anyone. The parents were both industrial, successful people with a good relationship, interested and able to parent. They presented no evidence of neurotic or characterological problems. Of course not. In particular, no parental contribution was discovered for the development of the child's symptoms. Now, what are your hypotheses about this case? Is it an anxiety disorder? Let me ask a question. Is there any evidence of depression in this case with a child? Is there any evidence of depression? Any evidence of depression, ladies and gentlemen?
I don't really see any depression. I see most that his sleep is being disturbed.
He's distressed.
So if there's distressing, what categories of disorder in the DSM-5 will bring about this? That's what you need to think about. So you should be thinking about the diagnostic criteria. And it should be in relation to age of onset and duration of onset. So in this case, we need to go to the neurological developmental disorders. Am I correct? Am I correct? Does someone have a DSM-5 there?
I have one, Dr. Mark.
Okay. Let's look at it. Let's go to the... Let's do it together because time is going and as you know, I have to get to work. So, let's go to the neurodevelopmental disorders. Let me see. Let's look at it. So do you agree that he has anxiety?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Anything else you notice about this case with this child? The symptoms. What else do you notice? So let's go then. We looked in the neurodevelopmental disorder. It's not a developmental issue, so it would not fall under that. Let's look at the anxiety disorders to see if we can find something.
Right.
Could someone go to separation anxiety disorder for me, please? 309.21. In the ICD code, it is F93.0. Could someone read the developmental criteria for this childhood disorder? Under the anxiety disorder, this is one of the disorders that was in of childhood, that was previously in the disorders of infancy, childhood and adolescence, that has been moved to the anxiety disorders. Can someone read the criteria for separation anxiety disorder? Go ahead. If you find it.
Yes.
Could someone read it, please?
Separation anxiety disorder?
Yes.
Developmentally inappropriate and excessive fear or anxiety concerning separation from those to whom the individual is attached.
Stop it right there. Is there any evidence in the vineyard?
Yes, Dr. Mack. His mother.
Where is the evidence?
Prayer for being away from his mom.
Okay.
He used to be content.
Why do you think why he's afraid? So in other words, something has caused him to be afraid, to be disattached from his mother. Yes. Correct?
Yes, Dr.
Well, let us continue to examine the hypothesis. Continue to read, please.
As evidenced by at least three of the following.
And note, and make a make a comparison of these three criteria and match it against the developing symptoms. Do they correlate and do they sanction what the DSM is saying? If it doesn't correlate, it doesn't fit, we have to go somewhere else. But let's we're on a limb, we want to see. We talked about anxiety. Let us look at this phenomenon and see if it fits this. Continue, please.
1. Recurrent excessive distress when anticipating or experiencing separation from home or from major attachment figures.
Is there any evidence in the beginning? Is there any evidence? Yes or no? Is there any evidence?
He became reluctant and concerned about separation from his mother and father. So, I don't know if that could suffice in terms of his distress, the reluctancy about separation.
Okay, let's go to 2.
2, persistent and excessive.
At least three of the following. So if this one doesn't fit, let's go to another criteria within that same disorder. Continue, please.
Persistent and excessive worry about losing major attachment figures or about possible harm to them, such as illness, injury, disaster, death.
Is there any evidence in the vineyard?
No.
Well, he did exclaim when his father was bitten. I'm not sure whether that would qualify. Mm-hmm. Trying to find what he said. Maybe not.
Go to 4 and read paragraph 4, please. The answer will come to you. Could someone read paragraph 4 in the vineyard, please?
Prior to the meeting with the leper, the boy had been content to play outside by himself, and he was always happy to stay with a babysitter. However, with the accident, he began to show a reluctance and concern about being separated from his mother and father. His mother described his concern as more clingy.
Stop it right there.
Okay.
Is there any evidence in the diagnostic category?
1.
Yes, Dr. Ma.
Go back up to paragraph 3 and read, please.
Let's go to your number 1.
Let's go back to paragraph 3. The attack by the leopard. Someone read it, please.
The attack by the leopard marked the onset of the symptoms. Immediately after the attack, the child acted terrified.
Stop it right there. Okay. So when the child acted terrified, go back to paragraph 1. He would awake 2 to 4 times each night and would have frequent nightmares involving animals and monsters. Do you make the connection? Let's continue reading the DSM. Let's go back to the DSM. 3, please. Okay. Somebody read 3.
Persistent and excessive worry about experiencing an untoward event, example, getting lost, being kidnapped, having an accident, becoming ill, that causes separation from a major attachment figure.
Okay. Is that implied in the vignette?
Yes, Dr. Mack.
Okay. Continue with 4.
Persistent reluctance or refusal to go out, away from home, to school, to work, or elsewhere because of fear of separation.
Is that implied in the beginning?
Yes, Dr. Ma.
Continue.
Persistent and excessive fear of or reluctance about being alone or without major attachment figures at home or in other settings.
Is that in the meaning implied?
Could you read it again, Vanessa, please?
Sure. Persistent and excessive fear or reluctance about being alone or without major attachment figures at home or in other settings.
Thank you.
Is there any evidence of that in the minion? Seems to me, but let's look at six. Continue.
Persistent reluctance or refusal to sleep away from home or to go to sleep without being near a major attachment.
Where in the Vinay did this child wants to sleep with his parents? Did you not sleep there?
Yes.
Continue.
Repeated nightmares involving the theme of separation.
Stop it right there. Is there any evidence of nightmares in the Vinay?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Continue.
Repeated complaints of physical symptoms, example, headaches, stomach aches, nausea, vomiting, when separation from major attachment figures occurs or is anticipated.
Is there any evidence of that kind of behavior in the Vinay? His mother described this concern as more clinging. Whenever she went out, he would be full of questions as to where she was going, for how long, and when she was coming back. And either he showed an interest where his father was going, whether it was to work or out in the evening, he would constantly ask where his father was. He would demand to be told repeatedly about his father's exact whereabouts. Continue. Criteria B, please, Ms. Thompson.
The fear, anxiety, or avoidance is persistent, lasting at least 4 weeks in children and adolescents, and typically 6 months or more in adults.
Stop it right here. Duration of onset or time of onset, ladies and gentlemen.
Time of onset, Dr. Ma.
We have duration of onset.
Which one? Duration or time?
Time.
Duration.
Time of onset, Dr. Ma. Duration.
Some people say duration, some say time. Which one? Justify in the Vinay. Go to the Vinay, pick out the evidence, and tell me. Time or duration?
There is duration for the evidence that he had elapsed in terms of time attack. Determined to his duration.
Read it. Read again, Miss Thompson. Read again. Read this again, please. Read B again, can I please?
The fear, anxiety, or avoidance is persistent, lasting at least 4 weeks in children.
Stop it there. It says last at least 4 weeks. This is duration of onset. Hello.
Yes, Doctor Ma.
The DSM-4 criteria always talks about the duration of onset. So in children, the symptoms must last at least the minimum a month. But in his case, it lasted 5 months. Do you understand now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
6 months in adults and in teenagers, which means that they have had more time to go through because of their developmental course of it. So this is the DSM criteria looks at duration of onset. Time of onset is related to when the patient brings that problem to you. You ask them how long, when did it start, they tell you. But duration of onset is always in the DSM. Now, so let us look. So it appears this child has developed a separation anxiety disorder, early onset. Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, let's answer the questions quickly. The presence of psychiatric disorder in children can be explained in terms of? Just answer the question, either A, B, C, D, or E.
E
is correct. All of them. Two, indicate the diagnostic type. Which is in this case, which one is it? Is it organic, mental? Which is it?
Mental, Dr. Ma.
Or neurotic, which one?
Beautiful neurotic, I don't know. Mental, organic, medical, neurotic.
No, one is a distractor, so be careful. Is it organic, mental, medical, or neurotic? Which one?
I think neurotic, Dr. Mark, because of the distress.
You're very correct, yes. Three. Which of the following domains is not true of general psychiatric syndromes and symptoms in children? Emotional problems, conduct problems, developmental delays, secure attachment. Which one? Take a guess. It's pretty straightforward.
Emotional.
And I gave those to you, and I also gave you those notes. So, which one?
Emotional problems, Dr. Ma, because those are usually adult problems.
Think again. You certain? It says not true of general psychiatric syndromes and symptoms. Which of the four is not true? I think it's secure attachment.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, give me the DSM-4 TR axes. Tell me the five axes, please. One.
Substance and medical substance.
What?
No, forget it.
I think you're going into what I call hypnagogic sleep.
I think so too. Because I'm supposed to know them.
Go ahead, tag up with your brilliance.
No, not right, I'll send
you a glass of Chateau Cabernet Sauvignon. Over the phone.
Right,
come on, you can do it. What's access one? Or what's the main diagnosis?
Is it substance related disorders, Dr. Ma?
I beg your pardon?
Okay then.
clinical disorders.
Okay.
What is the diagnosis for this child disorder or problems?
Huh? Oh, that's what you're asking.
I thought you were asking. Right.
No. I'm asking about the child's disorder. Tell me what it is.
Anxiety disorder.
What type?
Separation anxiety.
Okay, that's correct.
Oh, that was the question, Dr. Mark?
Yes.
I thought you were asking us to give you
the five
axes.
The five axes.
Yes, but continue with the axes now.
Okay.
What's on two?
Personality disorder.
No. Who's talking about?
I'm confused, Dr. Mack. Is it that you want to know what is on
two? I said I want the five axes for DSM-4 TR.
Nothing on two.
Okay,
on two.
Continue, please.
On three, stressor?
No. What number is on axis three in the DSM-4 TR? I gave that to you.
Isn't that stressor?
No, medical disorder. He doesn't have a medical problem. Yes, he does. He has a history of tonsillitis. So you'd have coded on axis four, you'd have had to code it tonsillitis on axis three.
But Dr. Mark, would we put tonsillitis in there though, even though it just briefly mentioned that he just had the operation to have it removed?
Yes, it is. Okay. You need to code it. It is codable. Okay. Yes, okay. You need to code it. Mention he has a problem with tonsillitis. That's why it was there.
Okay.
What is a stressor? What's axis four? What is a major stressor in the vineyard? What happened to him?
The leopard died.
So he had a traumatic episode.
Right.
So that's axis four. Give me a GAF score. Put it in numbers. Remember I said below 40 is severe, and I gave it mild is between certain range, moderate. Give me a GAF score.
Fifty. He's somewhat functional, not fully, but somewhat.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Mark, would it be too much of a trouble just to mention the mild, moderate, and severe ranges again, please?
Okay. No, remember I said the GAF scores are not normally reported again in the five, but for this purpose of understanding the severity of the symptoms, you need to use this. So I said the GAF score called Global Assessment Functioning in the DSM-4 TR.
Sorry, Dr. Mark, I understand. I don't want you to have to go through that again. Could you give me the ranges, please?
The ranges,
yes, Dr. Mark.
Between 65 and up is mild.
Okay.
In the 65 to 100.
Okay.
Under between 60. Between 60 and 55.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking at 60 and 60. You're looking at more
Moderate
range.
Okay.
Below that, which is 40, you have severe range.
Okay. That's what I was really asking, because I understand the DSM-5 category of severe.
Yes, so the DSM-5 will just give you what if you make the comparison with the DSM-5, you will have the principal diagnosis, correct, which is separation anxiety disorder. The category will be under anxiety disorders. What else would you have? Would you have access to? No, you would not. Would you have access to? No, you will just list that he has had. What will be the contextual issue in the vineyard, in the DSM-5 nomenclature? What will be the contextual issues with the DSM-5 with this child?
Meaning the stress.
Yes.
The bite from the leopard.
Yes, he has had a traumatic episode, and as a result, he's having sleep disturbances and anxiety.
Dr. Mack, I realize you're not using the term leopard bite. We just need to say traumatic episode. We don't need to specify.
You could put traumatic episode, but say put in bracket, bitten by leopard.
Okay.
Okay, but you need to make it, you know, to make it more general. More general. Traumatic. He did have a traumatic. It's trauma.
Okay.
But it's not really PTSD because it doesn't give that impression. He says that he has a separation anxiety. Okay, so of course you do the differential diagnosis of the case that it could not be separate, it could not be anxiety disorder.
I'm sorry, Dr. Matt, did we settle on a GAF score?
No, we did not. What's a GAF?
Somewhere in the moderate range, which would be, for me, I'm just saying, somewhere in the moderate range, which would be...
Between what?
Between 60 and 55.
55 and 60?
Yes, Dr. Ma.
Okay. Anybody else agree with her? Anybody else? Anybody else, please?
Sure.
I'm agreeing with that, Dr. Ma.
You agree?
Yes.
I agree with the moderate range, Dr. Ma.
It seems more like it. I would agree with that range. Okay, now this is now what you need to do. Basically, the exam is giving you an idea to be able. I'm not expecting you to be experts in this. You just started this. What I'm expecting to do is to use the DSM-4 to think. Look at the symptoms, determine the category of this, what likely category is this. So if it's come up with a series of disorders. Is it anxiety? Is it a neurodevelopmental disorder? Is it depression, depressive disorders? And then you go and verify in the DSM. But you need to use the DSM to be able to think and answer the question. That's why you get these cases, because you need to be exposed. Now I am not going to tell you how many pages you need to write. I can't do that. What I want you to do is answer the questions. So you will need to do some research. Now, people have been asking about the December 31st deadline. Can people now, at this point in time, can people turn the assignments on the December 31st? Is it feasible? Is it workable?
No, Dr. Ma.
Not at this level. Not at these levels, Dr. Ma.
At this level?
No, that's not what I mean. Forget, no, that's not what I mean. I mean, okay, with the amount of work that you have here.
That's not a lot of work.
Of course.
I could do that in an hour.
The first one, you want us to do a case conceptualization using the method with the DSM-5. Speaking of which, we are not supposed to cite the DSM-4 at all, Dr. Mack?
You can cite it, as I said before, for these purposes, but if you go outside the site, you're not allowed to do that.
Okay. No, Dr. Mack, this is not possible for the 31st, especially with the individual project.
Okay, so what are people? So people, so what is another? What's a date in January that you can come up with?
The 5th of January.
What date is that?
The first Monday.
Are people in agreement? Say aye or nay. Hello? But will the library be open by then?
That's when it will be open. That's the day when it's opening.
Mr. Nyame, by the way, Mr. Nyame? Mr. Nyame? The EBSCO online is not working?
No, I've got to check it, but I was warned that it may not be working by the librarian. So I'll have to check if it's still on.
So do you think we should give the students more time to complete the assignment when the library is open?
Yeah, I believe so. Because
an extra week?
Depends on what about your time. Do they have any other?
We have a course starting on the 8th of January.
There you go.
So we have to put that into consideration when the next course starts. It has to be that the next course, maybe you could consider using the next course as the barometer.
The 8th of January for them to turn it in.
Yes.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm in a good mood, so I just had a glass of wine. And I will give you until the 8th of January. No more changes.
Dr. Mark, before you say no more changes, don't say it yet. let me just pull on your good mood some more. So you wanted two projects in at that time, Dr. Mark?
No, I suggest that you write one, Miss No. Go ahead and get one in by the 31st.
Just asking. I was just seeing how far the wine was going, Dr. Mark. But you look like it can't stretch.
Are you saying that you want both in by the 8th of January? Is that what people are saying?
Okay, Dr. Mark.
No. I'm asking a question. Is it that
the possibility? If the possibility exists, we could still send it in on the 31st. But as for me, I'm having some severe challenges, so that would work for me. Certainly, I'll try to get it in before.
All right. I put tell this. I will allow people to turn it in by the 31st of December to the 8th of January. How is that?
Fantastic.
Thank you, Dr. Mark.
Okay.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Mark.
Well, I'm going to
take another sip.
I am going to take another sip. That's right.
Oh my goodness.
In a nightcap.
Dr. Mark, I need to talk to you as well.
Okay. All right, so I think we have to convene the class. We have, it's a marathon, it's after 11. I need to get going to get rest. So, are there any questions?
Not at this time from me, Dr. Mark.
Well, no questions, anybody?
None from me, Dr. Mark.
Well, it is. I must say it has been a pleasure serving and teaching you, and I wish you all the best in your coursework.
Thank you, Dr. Mark, and it was really good having you as our teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And you downloaded a lot into us, and just the passion that you have for teaching and the passion you have to ensure that we understand and
patience.
And, you know, that is really rare because you have teachers who really can't be bothered sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, sometimes it was long and arduous, but we pushed on and we really want to appreciate you for that.
Okay, well.
And your knowledge and brilliance. Let's not forget that.
No. You're brilliant.
But it stunned us, Michelle.
Stunned. That's correct, Vanessa. You stunned. No, it really, really. You know, Dr. Mack, I must tell you,
mm-hmm.
on Sunday they had on profile of a clinical neuropsychologist.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the things that you spoke about in the class on Saturday, when I heard her, you know, mention some areas, like the executive areas of the brain and so forth and so on. You know, it was just such a wonderful feeling to have. And I said, wow, Dr. Matt just taught us that yesterday, and here it is that this lady is not speaking about.
Who is it? Who was being interviewed?
Her name is Dr. Tamika Haynes Robinson.
Okay. Yes, I know. Yeah, I know who she is.
So, I mean, you're right. You are, you know, quite knowledgeable, and we really appreciate you for that and for sharing.
Well, thank you. And like I said before, people can feel free to email if you need clarification on the
exam
assignments. the assignments. The question just is makes you to learn to think and up. It's more application of, so you can use anything in the course to answer the question. But you need to use a library, so I'm going to give you that time to use a library. Hopefully the EBSCO is on.
Okay, Dr. May. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, I'm sorry I didn't.
Thank you, Dr. Mark. Yes. Thanks to Coach Joe as well for sticking it out with us.
Yes. Thanks, Coach Joe.
You're welcome. So I will see people. Hopefully, I'll see you in next year in a couple more months.
Yes, Dr. Mark.
For the child course.
Dr. Mark, don't leave. Remember, I need to talk to you.
Oh, okay.
Bless Christmas to everyone. And you, the Dr. same Mac to as well.
You. And the same to you, Vanessa.
We're not ending in prayer. We're not praying before we leave.
Yes, Katia, you go ahead.
Oh, yes.
Oh, okay. All right, let us pray, colleagues. Dr. Mac.
Mm-hmm.
Most loving and righteous Father, we give you thanks tonight, Heavenly God. We truly want to thank you for the opportunity to have gone through this course. Lord, we are enriched, we are informed, we are knowledgeable, so much better than we have started, which means that learning had taken place, God, and we give you thanks for our lecturer. Truly, Lord, it's a blessing to be able, at the end of a course, to say it was good being a part of it, and we can conclude that tonight, God, and we give you thanks for just giving us the patience, for opening up our minds, God, the encouragement, and that added strength we need just to press on, despite how much it had seemed. We thank you for the network of people we were working with, the fellow students who have been patient, supportive, likewise, Kojo, who has been there, fixed computers and everything else that he did. We give you thanks, oh God. You are truly an orchestrator of every good thing, and we praise you tonight, Heavenly Father. We pray even as we go now, Lord, we have not ended because the coursework needs to be done, and we are continuing to look to you. Just continue to guide and bless, and even as we go into the Christmas, we pray, oh God, that you just be with us even throughout, protect us, and may we have a blessed time as we reflect upon your Son's coming. Mighty God, we thank you for all these things, and anything I fail to mention tonight, grant it, I pray, in Jesus' name, according to your will.
Amen.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you, Michelle.